We come together again this morning to enjoy the warmth of community, to rekindle the fire of commitment to our values, and to renew our faith in the goodness and beauty of life. It's been so many months since we were able to shake one another's hands and share the comfort of welcoming hugs. Nonetheless, as we meet today online, connected only on our screens, we can still see the reflection of love and community in one another's eyes. I'm Joyce Thompson, one of the worship associates at Community Unitarian Universalist Church in Plano. We have a very special program this morning, a question and answer service by our wonderful Pastor Kris. I glanced at our website this morning and it suggested that we could interrogate her about almost anything, but someone crossed out interrogate and substituted ask. Sounds a little plighter. We Unitarian Universalists don't automatically absorb answers from up there. We each pursue our own quest to discover truth and meaning. Questions and curiosity are our lifeblood, and a service like this is like waving catnip in front of us. But insofar as satisfying our curiosity, we live in convenient times in that regard. When I have a question, and I have questions all the time, I Google it or I ask Alexa. But now, even better, we can ask Pastor Kris. The questions our congregation has submitted should be every bit as interesting as her responses. I can't wait to hear them.
Spirit of life, wordless presence we know, even if we cannot or do not name you, by all that is holy and good in the world, please preserve curiosity. Yours and mine and all of ours, God save us from absolute certainty and knowing the answer. Bring us together today, Holy Spirit who blows where she will. Your breath moved first over the waters. You blew open the windows and the doors on Whit Sunday, sweeping arrogance out, leaving behind only stories and the tongues to speak them. Help us breathe in your brash and brassy quest for wisdom and make it our own. You, yes, you, right there, all of you. You breathe out life every day in your questions and in your compassion and in our shared meaning making, the storytelling that we do on this road that we travel together. It's your breath and mine that takes that holy curiosity and shapes it into something alive, this community of seekers. Breathe in with me now. When you're ready, exhale. Let us begin together now, our shared spirits having crafted the curious worship to come.
These are difficult days, and at times we struggle to remain brave. At times our own light goes out, especially when the power goes out in our homes. But at times our own light goes out and is rekindled by a spark from another person. Each of us has cause to think with deep gratitude of those who have lighted the flame within us. We are a feisty bunch, holding to diverse beliefs, seeking truth and clarity with free and open minds. There is no claim of absolute authority here. No single creed binds us together. Instead, we choose voluntarily to join together on the basis of shared values. And we reaffirm this choice every week by reciting our covenant together. Please join me in saying, love is the spirit of this church and service is its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in freedom, and to help one another.
Still somehow
The eighth letter in a sequence of correspondence lasting over 5 years. From Worpswede near Bremen, July 16th, 1903. About 10 days ago, I left Paris tired and quite sick and traveled to this great northern plain whose vastness of silence and sky ought to make me well again. But I arrived during a long period of rain. This is the first day it has begun to let up over the relentlessly blowing landscape. And I am taking advantage of this moment of brightness to greet you, dear sir. My dear Mr. Kappas, I have left a letter from you unanswered for a long time. Not because I had forgotten it. On the contrary, it is the kind that one reads again when one finds it among one's other letters, and I recognize you in it as if you were very near. It is your letter of May 2nd, and I'm sure you remember it. As I read it now in the great silence of these distances, I am touched by your beautiful anxiety about life, even more than when I was in Paris, where everything echoes and fades away differently because of the excessive noise that makes things tremble. Here, where I am surrounded by an enormous landscape, which the winds move across as they come from the seas, here I feel that there is no one anywhere who can answer for you those questions and feelings which, in their depths, have a life of their own. For even the most articulate people are unable to help, since what words point to is so very delicate, is almost unsayable. But even so, I think that you will not have to remain without a solution if you trust in things that are like the ones that my eyes are now resting upon. If you trust in nature, in what is simple in nature, in the small things that hardly anyone sees and that can suddenly become so huge, immeasurable. If you have this love for what is humble and try very simply as someone who serves to win the confidence of what seems poor, then everything will become easier for you, more coherent and somehow more reconciling. Not in your conscious mind, perhaps, which stays behind, astonished, but in your innermost awareness, awakeness, and knowledge. You are so young, so much before all beginning, and I would like to beg you, dear sir, as well as I can, to have patience with everything unresolved in your heart, and try to love the questions themselves, as if they were locked rooms or books written in a very foreign language. Don't search for the answers which could not be given to you now because you would not be able to live them. And the point is to live everything, live the questions now. Perhaps then someday far in the future, you will gradually, without even noticing it, live your way into the answer. Thank you. All right, so you submitted your questions online, and I have to admit, the week got away from me a little. I don't know, maybe a few of you too. And so I want to let you know, I didn't do a whole lot of like in-depth research. A couple of the questions I would really love to look into more, and I plan to, but I'm gonna give you my best information that I have, and we will go from there. A lot of these are just simply sort of, what do you think about this? So that makes it easier, less research needed. The first thing I want to say is that these services are fun. You know, there's always like the whole stump the chump kind of thing going on. But also, curiosity is for me one of my very, very deepest core values. If I stop being curious about the world, that's probably the moment at which you can mark the start of my death. That's how I feel about it, that powerfully. And so I believe that questions are sacred. And I think that learning to ask good questions is important. I won't say such a thing like there's no bad questions. Of course, there are no bad questions. You can ask anything you want. But there are questions that are going to get you better answers and more useful and meaningful answers than others. For instance, I always wonder when people ask me, do you believe in God? If they think that that's a good question, because I don't. I think it's a bad question. Who's God? Which God? How do they act? Is it your God? Is it my God? Is it my parents' God? Is it those people over there? That's what I want to know. So ask me, what kind of a God do you believe in? Or do you believe in a God who would do this, that, or the other? Those are more specific. So that's what I mean when I say good questions. And my cat is coming over here to visit. So we'll do that. All right, don't pay any attention to the cat tail that's about to go across your screen. Oh, good. He's laying down right in front of the mic, guys. So the first question I want to talk about, because, you know, it's one of those questions about the start. When does life begin? Conception? Viability? Birth? So for me, the answer is viability or birth, which is frankly kind of the same thing. Viability means the point at which an infant can survive outside the womb. And if they are born early, but they can survive outside the womb, clearly they have begun their lives. And so that's kind of my feeling about it. I understand people's stances on anti-abortion. I do, because it's a serious thing. You are making a decision about your life from then forward. At the same time, I feel that scientifically, there's no reason to cast a whole bunch of guilt and shame on women if they choose to end a pregnancy early in the first term. And certainly women who end a pregnancy in the second or third term are doing so out of a medical necessity. They are not doing it for pleasure. We already have safeguards in place for that. So I'll just say this. They talk about the fact that you can hear fetus's heartbeat at 6 weeks, but in fact, it's a collection of cells and electrical stimuli that you can reproduce in a petri dish. I also think that if you're truly I think there's a difference between being pro-life and anti-choice. Generally, I think of the pro-life movement as being extremely anti-choice. They seem very interested in controlling other people's bodies, and not particularly interested in actual things that end abortion. Because to be pro-life is to be pro-life from, like, I'm going to decide to use reproductive health care to choose when I have my children, all the way to, you know, these children over here are locked in cages at the border. Perhaps that's not an okay thing to do if I claim to love life. So I feel like pro-life means taking care of humans, and that includes women humans who should have control over everything that happens all up in here and down in there and everywhere else. And if that is a problem for somebody, I would ask them to look at themselves and ask how they would feel if I asked them to go through like all kinds of medical dangers and things like that just because I felt uncomfortable with how they expressed their sexuality. So that's how I feel about that. The end. I'm pro-choice. The next question, a tougher one, actually, is non-human life as valuable as human life? This is a huge question. And I think the answer is yes. I do think that non-human life is as important as human life because that's part of us. You can't just separate it out. It's not like you can take the interdependent web of all existence and pluck out like mosquitoes, because then you got things like fish going hungry, and then you got things like animals and people going. I mean, it's just, there's no way you can untangle those threads that hold us together. And so I think that when we think about this question, you also want to think about what are the realities of biology on this planet. Yes, I think life is valuable, but I'm rarely given to think that life is... I will say this. I think that there are things that are worth giving your life up for. I hope I'm never faced with that choice, but I, you know, keep it in the back of my mind because I think it's important that we know that also humans are not a whole lot more important than other species too. And so there are times where we can choose to die for what we believe in, or there are times where we are sort of picked upon because of nature and the matter, you know, the fact that we have invaded and destroyed much of the habitats around the world. Human overpopulation is not just an issue of like, can we feed everybody? Do we have enough clean air, clean water, clean soil for everybody? It's also about, do we have any habitat left for all the other creatures that we depend on in the interdependent web? So I will say this, I am not a vegetarian. I guess that's one of the basic questions that people want to ask when it comes to this. That's a choice that I made just based on my own needs and my history and my past. But also I'm aware that that might not be sustainable. I'm perfectly happy to go to a vegetarian or vegan lifestyle at the point at which we do that. But I do like bacon, and it's embarrassing but true. And I'll say this too about people, about life. I will say that I like my cats and my dogs better than most humans. Although I wish this one would stop getting in front of the camera. So I'll just, that's my kind of similar answer, my sort of answer to that. It's a hard question. It's very complicated. It turns out when I was, you know, made some notes for myself. And then at the end of life, do you think anything happens after death? Yes, I think everything keeps happening. I'm just not there to see it. So that's a simple way of saying I believe that there's no wasted energy in the universe. You can look to physics for it. You know, E equals mc squared. You can either have matter or you can have energy, and they can transform into one another, but you can't ever like get rid of them completely. So my soul, or my energy that I've put out, that I'm putting out to you right now, I will be gone, and so the source of that energy will be gone, but the energy itself is already out in the world doing what it needs to do. My belief as far as life after death is that it's just going to sleep and that you're done. I'm not afraid of the time before I was born, so I'm going to seek very hard not to be afraid of the time after I live. That's all well and good, but of course we're humans and we have that instinct that says stay alive no matter what. The other half of that is, I say that I don't believe in life after death. And again, I should say everything on this, that every question, this is all just me. It's not you. It's not necessarily other Unitarian ministers. You know, so it's just me. But I do have many friends who are hospice workers, both nurses, doctors, and chaplains, and folks who have worked in hospitals and have been around death much more on a daily basis than me. And I will say that I can't deny when they tell me they've had experiences like at the deathbed with patients where there seemed to be a presence after the patients had passed, or there seemed to be other things that were being influenced. I can't deny that. I wasn't there. And it may just be an individual experience that you had to be there for. But even though I don't necessarily believe in life after death, I always, as I say with most things, I reserve the answer to change my mind at any time. And I don't want to put the kibosh on anybody else's beliefs about life after death. I will say this, I do not believe in hell, and I do not believe it's a good way to relate to people. So that's what makes me a universalist. So I had a question about whether in seminary or elsewhere I've read any scholarly teachings about Jesus being in India or in Asia and having encounters with Buddhism. And what about, then the last part of it is, what about life after crucifixion? So I will say a life after crucifixion is, well, there's not much life after crucifixion because it kills you. I don't believe in the whole like empty tomb. I think there were all kinds of amazing things that probably happened, but I also think that we build up stories to make these events last longer, and it's a 2,000-year-old story, so there you go. As far as Jesus being in India or Asia, I know that there are very early Christian communities in parts of India that seem to have been founded within the first 500 years after Christ's death. I mean, so that's 1,500 years ago, something like that. And so when we look at that, yes, it says there was definitely an influence from Jesus followers in India. Those communities are still there today, and they have some very unique practices and traditions that, Google it, it's really fascinating. But I don't personally think that probably Jesus ever got out of, Judea. But I will say this, if you love this idea, and I do think that a lot of Jesus' teachings have many similarities with Buddhism, so that's kind of amazing. There's a book, it's a fiction book, it's called Lamb, The Gospel According to Biff, Christ's Childhood Pal. It is hilarious, it is amazing, and it's all about Jesus' life when he was about 5 years old to the end. And so I highly recommend it. It's hilarious, and I try to reread it about once a year. And it does talk about Jesus going to India and Asia, all kinds of places. So there you go. It's not scholarly, but it sure is fun. So now we're getting a little bit more close to home with the questions, closer to CUUC. So this question, how hard is it to minister to a church long distance? Well, it's so hard to say. I would say at first it was 200%. If a regular ministry job is 100%, at first it was 200% harder. It was like twice as much time, twice as much energy, anxiety, all that good stuff. But I think you guys all know that too, because you probably experienced something similar at the beginning of the pandemic. At this point, it's not twice as hard, but I will still say it is harder in a lot of ways. It's easier in some. I love not having to ever leave my house to go to work. It's pretty great, I'm not gonna lie. At the same time, I miss you guys so much. Like, I miss your faces. I didn't become a minister so that I could do this online, although I'm happy to do it online if I have to. I became a minister because I love people, and I love relationship and connection. And we have those things, we've crafted those things, and I'm so proud of us, but also it's just not the same. You know it just like I do. We can't hug each other, we can't shake hands, we can't look closely into each other's eyes, and I miss that a lot. So that's a hard, hard part of it for me. And I will add this one last thing. I have to admit that I'm very excited for the time, whenever it comes, that we're back together again, but I'm also a little nervous because I was only at Community UU for 2.5 months as a half-time minister when the pandemic hit, and I don't know how it'll go when I'm in the building with all of you beautiful people. But I do say this, you've given me faith and hope through this whole thing, and so I have faith that you'll help me through when we're back together. And I have so much hope that we will continue this good work that we've done during this hard time into the future with each other. So it's hard to work long distance, and I can't wait to be back in person, but I do like wearing pajamas to work. So that's the answer to that one. What is CUUC's biggest challenge in the next 2 years? That's a big question to ask someone. I will tell you what I see as the biggest challenges right now, but I think honestly it would be good for you to talk to your board members too, or your team leaders around you. I think one of the hugest challenges is integrating families into the life of the church. Families come to church. We had an amazing RE program that, for reasons way outside of most individuals' control, has taken a hit in the last, say, 15 months. But that doesn't mean that we don't have families now and that we don't want new families to come in, because of course we do. I'll say this. I grew up Unitarian Universalist. I'm one of those weird 10%ers. 90% of our people come from outside places and find us. 10% of us are the lucky ones to get raised UU, or at least I consider myself lucky. I think every child should be raised in a UU church. I mean, we answer their questions, we listen to their questions, we don't shame them, we don't discipline with threats or fear. And I just, after having talked to so many of my seminary friends who were really literally raised with the fear of God and hell from day one as a constant threat held over their heads, I think every child should be raised UU. I also think that although we have a vibrant social life in the church, a lot of it is for the grown-ups and the grown-ups alone. So I think it would be great if we were able to plan more events and services that didn't just have the kids there, but had the kids doing, you know? So there are some thoughts about that that the RE board is cooking up, and we're looking forward to getting some help in that regard soon. But yeah, I think that family integration is one of our biggest challenges. The other is basically just any of our social justice challenges. It's hard to rank them. I would say that racial equity and understanding white supremacy culture in our own church is a huge thing and a huge part of what we do. And I think that's good work that we will have to continue. It's an ongoing challenge for us mostly white churches. And then I think climate justice is probably the other huge issue for most of us. There's something about climate justice that it's at the very bottom of what you have to do. If there's no climate, none of us will survive to establish racial equity and, you know, non-homophobic laws and things like that. So I think climate and racism are the two justice issues that I particularly feel that we are called to where we are. So that's just me, though. Again, ask all these other people. Ask each other. Talk to each other. Then tell me. All right. So this is a pretty specific question, but it's a good one. Could CUUC offer grief counseling or support services once we're together again for folks who are going through the loss of a loved one by death, or through a divorce, or through all the other many circumstances that come along in our lives and kind of knock us on our heels and remind us that life is fragile? It's a hard thing to be reminded of. So the first thing I want to say is I'm available for you for pastoral care anytime you want. I will do it again. I will put my cell phone number in the chat today. I don't mind if you all have my phone number in your phones. Just text me so I know it's not a stranger. But I will always answer the phone, and I will talk to you. And if you're going through grief right now, I'm happy to be a person who walks with you for that. But there's always a but. I'm a minister, and I think I'm a pretty damn good minister, but I'm not a professional counselor, and I'm not a social worker. I have training in those things, but not specifically. I'm certainly no expert. I am an amateur. I'm saving my status for the Olympics. So what that means is, at some point, pretty early in the process, anytime that I'm working with any of you, I'm gonna say, well, what do we need to do? who can we bring in who can give us professional guidance on this? So if we were going to offer grief counseling services or support groups, I would want that to include, if not be directed by, people who are actual counselors and, you know, therapists. I do not think that it's a good thing to take people's mental health into your hands without knowing just what you're doing. It's so easy to do more harm than good. So I am definitely open to that idea, and I wonder if there are some places we could partner with, maybe some of the colleges where they've got grad students working on psychology degrees, something along those lines, just spitballing. But I couldn't figure out who left that question. I'll go try to figure it out again. But if it was you, reach out to me. Let's talk. Let's talk about that. I have a great question. What are some Unitarian Universalist tips for culturally responsive parenting? And this came up in the context of we have someone who's got a grandchild who's being raised bilingually and biculturally, and they want to know how to foster that and help that happen and also like get into it themselves and understand it. And I think there's some simple steps you can take. In general, educate yourself, you know, as well as you can. There are several great books out there about parenting a bilingual child. I can put some links to that in the chat after the service. You can also check on the UUA website. There are books about parenting that would include things about, you know, bicultural and interfaith parenting too, which is a huge UU thing. So there's those two things. Another suggestion I have would be ask if you don't already speak the second language that these children are being raised in. Can you learn that language? And if you can't, but you still want to stay engaged, ask your grandchild to teach you the words. Say, hey, how do you say this? And that helps them remember in both ways. Raising a bilingual child is much more complicated than I would have thought. I had a friend who did it, and that kind of educated me. But basically, in most households, the child, only the second language is spoken in the house. And that is so that it's just in the child's brain. In some cases, you'll have one parent speak one language and the other speak the other. That also works. But it's an intense process, and it also involves people outside the home, as you grandparents are finding out. There are ways to help and ways to hinder. That's the other thing. Ask the parents what they want you to do. And here's where the UU part comes in. UUs are wonderful, amazing people, and we also have a history of appropriating other cultures for our own use and benefit without compensating them. So I have no problem with UU Buddhists. I consider myself a person who follows Buddhist practices in some ways. But there's a difference between that and between putting on a robe and shaving my white American head and, you know, all those things that you can do to look Buddhist. They're not mine. I wasn't raised in that culture. It's rare in the US if anybody was. And so I'm thinking also, like, for instance, if the second language is Spanish, which it often is in Texas, Texans, we love Mexican stuff, let's be real, tacos, please give me some more, all those things we take great pride in, our breakfast tacos, our food, our spiciness, our fun parties on Cinco de Mayo, but at the same time, we are treating the actual Latina population of Texas as second-class citizens. And that is what I mean by you can, at that point, once you're partying, but they're still hurting, you're appropriating. You're not giving proper due to the culture of origin. So I will say checking out the differences between appropriation and appreciation is hugely important. And there are some great UUA resources on that, which I can point you to. Get in touch with me. So I hope that helps a little bit. I usually think of the difference as if I'm truly appreciative of something, I'm going to go participate as sort of an observer, an invited, hopefully, person to that culture's event. Whereas if I create the event and I benefit from it and no one from the culture benefits from it, that is appropriation. I'm going to do this one as a follow-up. Hey, I've got Spanish skills that, and how can I help Community UU with those? Whoever you are, thank you. I would like to direct you to the grandparents of a bicultural child, first of all. And then also, if you're interested in volunteering to do any Spanish speaking, I know that we have social justice projects, especially once we're out in the world again, where we interact much more with the Hispanic community than we currently are. I can imagine lots of ways that will be useful. So yes, there are ways you can help. And I so appreciate that you brought it up. It would be lovely to have a little more bilingual possibility and a good way to sort of expand our folks who have access to our services. So, all right. The hardest question. How do we reconcile with evangelicals / Trump extremists? And how do we restart dialogue with those people? There's a huge deficit, I would say, in reality and the beliefs of people who do follow these extreme sort of hardcore Christian dominionism, all that good stuff. And so here's what I'll say to that about how do we reconcile, how do we restart dialogue? systemically, I think we first address behaviors and actions. And we have consequences for those things. If you storm the US Capitol, you go to prison or rehab, whatever. But as long as we don't address those things, any change to the culture is not gonna happen. I mean, first of all, this is bad behavior. I don't think I'm saying anything like revolutionary by saying that it's not okay for people to consistently and constantly denigrate others and put them down and trash everybody around them who doesn't look just like them. It does harm, not just to the person doing the trashing, and certainly twice or three times as much to the person being oppressed or marginalized. It also hurts the whole community. Communities don't survive if they cannot get along. And so our job as members of the community is to create paths for people to stay in community. And first, that means addressing the bad acts and the bad behaviors. I don't think any talk of reconciliation is even possible until some wrongdoing has been acknowledged. You see what I'm saying? Like, I can say all I want, let's do reparations for African Americans who built all our colleges and our state houses. Let's do some reparations. Yes, I'm all for it. But that doesn't mean that every white person is even going to see the need for that. And so you can't have the conversation as long as the people on the other side don't believe that you are fully human and fully able to argue and have agency. So I'm not worried about that. I can't change their minds. All we can do is control the behavior. So I do believe in laws and policies to do that. Also, again, feel free to shame people who are being racist or being sexist or being homophobes. Feel free. Can we just not look at them and go, ugh? I mean, if they can't handle that, well, you know, there's a reason that snowflake is a word that's used. So that's my first thing. And that's sort of a systemic answer. Like, how do we reach across the aisle? Individually, this is a very different question, isn't it? Because in Texas, at least, can you escape knowing conservatives in your daily life and liking them? I love people who are Republicans. And so I don't want to like cut off communications with them. But how do you open dialogue if neither of you can agree on what the truth is? My only answer to this, it's not new, and it's kind of annoying because it's slow, but it just involves having the conversation. Not dragging it out at the dinner table at Thanksgiving to beat people with it, but just the next time you see your racist uncle or cousins or whoever, start talking about the good things that have happened through this government that they hate so much. Ask, you know, hey, did you get your stimulus check yet? Yeah, that was helpful. Here's what we used it for. What'd you use it for? Ask things like, how long did it take you to get your power back on. Did you see this article that says we could fix this? Yeah, let's fix this together. Rational and reasonable conversation about what people's actual life experiences are. I think it was who was telling us recently that they knew folks who had decided that the vaccine was terrible and they would inject things into you and nanotechnology and the devil, but they got their COVID shots. And that's weird, but also that's how humans are. So I would say at that point, you're ready for a conversation. Hey, how are you feeling after your COVID shot? Do you feel a little bit relieved? Are you doing okay? Does your arm, you know, just have that conversation and see if it can open up some ways to talk about reality, the reality that they share with you. Because it's easier for us to talk on that level and convince people of reality than it is to convince, you know, a faceless crowd. So it's hard. I also will add this. Any conversation that you have with people who are acting in harmful and death-dealing ways, have it on your terms of safety. If you cannot talk to people about this because it will affect your safety, your livelihood, your job, all those things, then don't. Protect yourself first. This, you are sacred, and you don't deserve to take abuse or be harmed just by opening a conversation. So always be willing to start the conversation, but also in the back of your mind, know that you have the power to, at any time, walk away. And that's okay. You don't have to do it cruelly. You can, but I don't recommend it. But you can always just say, you know what? I think I'm done with this conversation. So it's good to see you. See you next time. Or let's talk about the kids instead. You know, there are ways to move on. That's my only advice. And it's not all that, like I said, it's not insightful. It's not the first time you're going to hear it. But that actually is how people's minds get changed. I mean, why does Dick Cheney not hate lesbians? It's because his daughter is a lesbian. It's like, why do people take the COVID shot if they believe it's going to, you know, inject them with Satan? Well, because there's a part of them that also knows it's going to keep them safe. So let's talk to that part. Anyway, that's the best I can do with that. And it's one that I struggle with so hard. So I hope you'll forgive that. I think we probably all do. All right. Last question, guys. Here we go. It's a great one. How do we find joy in these hard times that we're going through? Well, individually, that's a hard question to answer. I have certainly in the past few years gone through issues where I felt incapable of experiencing joy. You know, grief or stress or high anxiety have kind of choked those things off for me. And I know I'm not the only one. So, no, I'm not always able to find joy in my daily life. I will say, though, that the times that have been the hardest where I have found joy, where joy has like come to me like a gift, is when I was helping other people. I can think of times where I'm thinking of a particular Thanksgiving when my husband was deployed in Iraq. I had two small children and I didn't know it, but I was getting sick with strep throat and I was like 14 hours away from having 103 degree fever. And I went to church and it was a Thanksgiving service and they were saying, oh, let's all be grateful. And I was just like, no, I have nothing to be grateful for. And I'm angry at you for asking me to be grateful. But, you know, I sat in my corner and kind of pouted. But what happened later is that I ended up helping deliver food, you know, bags of food to people for their Thanksgiving meals. And it was just three houses that I went to and dropped off these bags. And in every house, there was some small joy that happened. If it was just the hello at the door, people inviting you in. Oh my gosh, the two of the families had kids and I just got to play with other people's kids. And to me, that's the most joyful thing you can do. And so that's huge for me is that I can receive joy in my hard times by helping others. I'll also say that community is the way that we foster, and I don't just mean community Unitarian Universalist Church, although I do, but I mean our communities. That's how we find joy, is we use our hearts and our heads and our hands. We have conversations. We do good work together. And that's where joy comes from. Joy is one of those things that it can come from nature, but for most of us, we're not out in nature all the time. That's coming up. I'm going to add that in a second. But it's also something that we can get from one another and we can give to one another. And so I think just remaining open to the possibility of it, even in our hardest, yuckiest times, we can still have some joy. Now, as a community, I think we can create joy in all these activities that we do together. There's a bridge club, there's charades, there's trivial pursuits, there's the stewardship team that's going to come talk to you. There's all kinds of ways that we connect with each other that bring us great joy. So that's one thing. The last thing I have to say is get away from humans. Okay. Like, just leave them behind. If you really, really need joy, go outside and look up at the stars. Look down at the grass, grab the nearest cat or dog that wants to be petted and just hold on to them. That is the greatest comfort that there can be for me anyway. And just kind of get outside your own head. It's hard when we're depressed, when we're in grief, but there are these moments where we are allowed to get a little bit out of ourselves. And those are the moments we could have joy. And so just remain open to those as we go. So I think that is the last official question. I am going to give us 10 minutes if anybody would like to ask a question. You can unmute yourself and ask, or you can put it in the chat. That might be easier.
I had two questions to you in that chat. My first one was, what does your God look like, if you have any? And then also, that was a question to you, the religious education
versus appropriation.
Yeah. What do you feel like, what are your thoughts on that?
So religious education, because we are we have a wide variety of beliefs, and we believe also in kind of seeking other new ways to truth. We do explore other religions, both through our religious education, which is what RE stands for, and through just our services. You know, you've seen elements of pagan and earth-centered beliefs in our services. We've seen Buddhist elements, things like that. I think it's kind of the same question. Am I doing this for myself, and am I adopting it without doing any intense, deep consideration of like, what is my relationship to this culture? Or am I doing it because it's just fun? And am I also telling other people, like, yeah, you too can be a sort of, you know, on the weekends Hindi, or you can be, it just seems like something that, or for instance, this is a weird one, but I know that prayer beads are not solely a Catholic thing, but I do know seminarians who do not have a tradition that uses prayer beads at all, who were very into rosaries. And I don't have a huge problem with that. It's not like the Catholic Church is suffering from oppression from me. But at the same time, I find it slightly inappropriate in that I wouldn't do it myself, because I don't have a lifetime of experience of using these beads to both pray, to do my, you know, to repent for my daily sins, which, you know, we all have them. I don't have that tradition in my culture or my life or myself. And so I would feel very appropriative doing that. But at the same time, I know it's important. So what do you do? Well, find a Catholic person, invite them in, have a conversation with them, find a person that you're already friends with better. So, or if that fails and you really want to teach people about, like, the rosary, for instance, in RE, invite a priest. They're happy to come, and many of them are super great. So I think it's always a matter of asking the culture to speak for itself rather than speaking for it as an outsider of the culture. I think that's a huge part of education versus appropriation. And again, I think it's just, it's a tricky subject. I can't give you a, this is appropriation, this is not, because life is complicated and most of us have some ties to other cultures just through the fact that we live in a diverse world. I am married to a Hispanic guy who has a traditional Mexican family. That doesn't make me Mexican, but it does give me a little bit of insight sometimes listening to them talk. So I just take that insight from them. I try not to pass it on to others because that would be appropriation. So it's a tough one. And then, oh, Angela, why would you ask me something great? Like, what does your God look like? Oh, well, I will say this. I am a true agnostic. I just don't know. I personally, my instinct and my upbringing, I would say, I consider myself to be mainly, in terms of God, secular. For me, it doesn't matter if God exists or not, because I'm going to do the same things I would do with God. You know, I'm going to try to help others. I'm going to try to live up to my best self. I'm going to try to integrate all the different parts of myself into a cohesive and healthy whole. I'm going to do that whether there's God or not. And I think that's a fairly UU position. Not all UUs, but many would agree with that. And so what I learned in seminary is that although I am still my secular, not really believing, very skeptical self, I'm also open. I'm open to God. I am open to a mystery. I am open to many things being bigger and wider and deeper than I could possibly understand. And so the language that I've learned to use is basically any God I could believe in would ABC. But it's not really a picture of God. It's sort of a picture of what I think is the good, which God, the good, same root, maybe the same thing. So I guess that's all I'll say on that. Let's see if other questions have popped up. Aw, there's a very kind question. Are you getting enough help from us to make your job okay? Do you need anything from us? Oh my gosh. Thank you. Thank you, thank you. You guys are wonderful. And that's just the God's honest truth. God, see what I did there? I have felt so entirely supported and helped and encouraged. And the times where I have done the wrong thing because I just didn't know the right thing, or at the times that I have inadvertently like stepped in somebody else's pie, I have had so much loving help to just like try stepping over here where it's not in someone's pie, or you don't need to do that because it's already all set up right there, you know, things like that. Oh my gosh. And I was shocked, and not shocked, but I was just so grateful for the support you guys showed when my mother died at the end of the summer. You guys are giving me everything that I need. I guess that's the short story. And I really appreciate that you asked. I'm very grateful for you all. So I am going to say that we are done now. And I am going to say thank you all for your wonderful questions. I hope I didn't like just bore you to death with my rambling. But I really do love you all. And I really do appreciate all the fun that we've had together, all the good hard work that we're doing and will do together. So I can't wait. The future is going to be good.
What's impossible, they forgot. This world keeps spinning, and with each new day I can feel a change in everything. And as the surface breaks, reflections fade. But in some ways they remain the same. And as my mind begins to spread its wings, there's no stopping curiosity. I wanna turn the whole thing upside down. I'll find the things they say just can't be found. I'll share this love I find with everyone. We'll sing and dance to Mother Nature's songs. I don't want this feeling to go away. I can't do everything, well I can try. And as I roll along I begin to find, things aren't always just what they seem. I wanna turn the whole thing upside down. I'll find the things they say just can't be found. I'll share this love I find with everyone. We'll sing and dance. This world keeps spinning and there's no time to waste. Well, it all keeps spinning, spinning round and round and upside down. Who's to say what's impossible and can't be found? I don't want this feeling to go away. Please don't go away. Is this how it's supposed to be?
The values that we share in this congregation are affirmed not only through reciting the covenant together. We also express our values and commitment to one another through generosity towards this church and to support its works, as well as to help our fellow congregants, some of whom are struggling through these difficult times. You can donate by mailing a check to our church address, or going to the church website and clicking on the blue Donate Now button. We thank you so much for your generosity.
Hello, my name is Duke Hildebrand, and along with Sarah Reiling, we will be co-chairing this year's Stewardship Drive. There are many of us who are involved in a multitude of spiritual, educational, fellowship, and social action activities, and who also financially support our self-supported church. That's right, Community UU Church is self-supported. Our operations and ministries are paid for by our members, mostly by pledges, not by the Unitarian Universalist Association. In fact, financially, it's the other way around. We help support the UUA. This year's Stewardship Drive will run through the month of March. We will be hosting cottage meetings on Zoom to talk about what the church means to all of you and to give you the opportunity to make a financial commitment in the form of a monetary pledge. Even though we haven't met in person for nearly a year, our expenses haven't significantly decreased, partly because we chose to be a fair employer to all of our staff via wage and salary continuance. We also want to continue Pastor Kris's recent increase to three-quarter time, ultimately getting to full-time. Feedback on Pastor Kris's service, both from the pulpit and in her pastoral role, has been overwhelmingly positive. We hope circumstances will soon allow us to physically gather again, where we can get back together better. Getting back together better. That's the theme for this year's stewardship drive. Does that bring any songs to mind? During this pledging period, you will be hearing from other members about their involvement in Community UU Church and what they do to support its covenant and mission. I hope you will also join us in supporting this church as we strive to build the beloved community, both here and in the surrounding community. What will you do to nourish spirits, work for justice, and transform lives?
As this service comes to a close, we mark its end by extinguishing the chalice. Please join me in saying, we extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again.
Full disclosure, this is one of my most cherished Unitarian Universalist readings. It's part of my earliest memories of identifying myself as a Unitarian Universalist because I questioned a lot of things, and luckily I was raised Unitarian Universalist, so that was welcomed. But out in the big wide world of, you know, elementary school and then junior high and even high school, that wasn't always true, and I had to sort of defend myself. And this reading spoke to me from a very young age. I just love its beauty and its imagery and its message most of all. So, as you go forth, cherish your doubts, for doubt is the attendant of truth. Doubt is the key to the door of knowledge. It is the servant of discovery. A belief which may not be questioned binds us to error, for there is incompleteness and imperfection in every belief. Doubt is the touchstone of truth. It is an acid which eats away the false. Let no one fear the truth that doubt may consume it, for doubt is a testing of belief. The truth stands boldly and unafraid. It is not shaken by the testing, for truth, if it be truth, arrives from each testing stronger and more secure. Those that would silence doubt are filled with fear. Their houses are built on shifting sands. But those who fear not doubt and who know its use are founded on rock. They shall walk in the light of growing knowledge. The work of their hands shall endure. Therefore, let us not fear doubt, but let us rejoice in its help. It is to the wise as a staff to the blind. Doubt is the attendant of truth.
Mm-hmm.